together the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our scripture lesson comes from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. This comes from one of the writings of the Apostle Paul. This is the reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner first for Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words. A reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generations, this mystery was not made known to humankind, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches of Christ and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God, who created all things, so that through the church the wisdom of God in its rich variety might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him.
Words from the Gospel according to Matthew, the second chapter, beginning with the first verse and reading through the 12th verse. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people, Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. Then they saw that the star had stopped. They were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. This is the written word of God for all of God's people.
Glory be to you, O Christ.
Amen. Have you noticed that you can walk outside around, say, 5 o'clock in the evening these days, and it's not quite dark yet? Almost. Give it about 5 or 6 or 7 minutes, and it's going to be dark, but it's not dark quite yet. The days are finally getting longer, slowly and slowly. Still the darkest and hopefully the coldest time of the year. So it seems the right time for us to hear Isaiah's words. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. There's something about the long darkness of winter that draws our attention to whatever light we can find, that causes us to truly see light, and that deepens our appreciation of it, our welcome of whatever light we can finally see. There's something about Christmas lights, something that shines out hope in the midst of despair, in the midst of uncertainty, in the midst of our own failure and our own frailty. That's why while walking or driving through the dark of evening during these early January days, I'm happy when I see Christmas lights. Still, Christmas lights. There are, after all, 12 days of Christmas, right? It's still Christmas. It's not just a song. The world at large might be finished with Christmas, but Christmas is not finished. Us. And so I take in the January Christmas lights. I hold on to the light a little while longer. It's part of what I want you to do this morning, to hold on to the light a little longer. On Christmas Eve, we held our candles and we sang Silent Night, Holy Night. All was calm, all was bright, and light began to spread from person to person and from candle to candle. And there were tears on some faces, and our hearts were filled with God and light, God's light. I want you to hang on to that light a little bit longer. There is something powerful, yet seldom overpowering, about light. Light wants to go everywhere. Put up a barrier to the light, and the light will go around it. Or it will try to find a tiny hole or crack to permeate. And it will succeed. It's no wonder that in the ancient Hebrew tale, the first words out of God's mouth are, "Let there be light." There is no end to what light can do. Light guides us on our way from here to there. In its absence, we must go and create our own light or find some other way. Sometimes light warns. Stop, it says. Pay attention. Be alert. Be careful. We used to live by a playground that belonged to the church I served at that time. And sometimes at night, some older kids would come and hide out at the playground. They weren't supposed to do that because it was closed. Well, I found this to be a good use for the back porch light. On and off and on and off, I would switch that light as if to say, somebody knows you're there, and you shouldn't be, so please go home. And when that didn't work, which was often the case, a flashlight out the back door, that was kind of fun. And watching those big kids scurry away. I remember when my sister began dating. She's a year older than I am. And at the end of the date, she and her boyfriend would sit in the car in the driveway for a while. And After a bit, mom or dad would get up. Usually dad was asleep, so it was mom. She'd get up and go to the front door and flip the light switch, the outside light on. A clear signal that it was time for one person to go home and another person to come inside. Not long after that, when I started dating, I was rather surprised to discover that my girlfriend's parents knew that same thing. I knew what it meant. Light warns, but light also welcomes. Come in, it says. Come on in. We're expecting you. And so the Magi, some would call them wise men, who often do, follow a star, light. Something that seems to say, come in. After all, light wants to go everywhere. It wants to reach to everybody, every person, and to say, come in. So there's more to this story than we often see in it. This Christmas story, the sweetness of the manger scene, and God coming to us as a tiny, weak, vulnerable child. That's a good start. But it's heavier than it looks. There's more to it than we realize. Because these Magi don't fit. They're not supposed to be there. They don't belong. They're the closest thing to modern-day astrologers the story could possibly offer. They probably read their horoscope every day and take it seriously. In fact, it's possible they write horoscopes. They are the Jean Dixon, the horoscope lady, in the form of three very oddly dressed guys. Three. And stargazing, star following, that wasn't on the menu of Jewish culture or Jewish religion. It wasn't okay, but it was the very thing that these Magi did. It was the very thing they were. It was what they were all about. Hebrew scripture, which we commonly refer to as the Old Testament, condemns people like these Magi. It says they're not good. Stay away from them. I'm not sure that some Christians, maybe even some of us, would think much of them today. In fact, some folks might even be inclined to start a crusade to get them out of the church or to keep them out, make them go away. But here they are in the story, in the picture. There's something about their openness, and there's something about their desire to seek and seek and seek until they finally find. There's something about all of that that should shed some light on your path and my path. And there's something about all of that that draws them to this light, this strange, ever-moving